last session of panel, so I hope you had a good lunch. So this is a panel that's going to look at how the drop in prices is affecting contract and fiscal terms in various countries and regions, and we have the chance of having four distinguished panelists and a distinguished chairperson, who is Philippe Daniel, who is now the chairman of the board of Oxcare here in Oxford. So before I let him run the panel, I just wanted to remind you that this is a public panel, so it's all going to be on video, and you're all welcome to tweet about it, quote any of the panelists during this session. And you're actually going to have substantial time after the presentations to ask questions and interact with the panel. We're trying to have as much of a debate as possible. And we also left you a little bit of a goodie, so you all have a handout of a blog that David Manley and I wrote this week to serve also as a kind of discussion background for this panel. So I hope you enjoy the next hour and a half, and I'm going to hand it over to Philippe Daniel now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Thomas. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm delighted to be chairing, even if I was billed as something that looks remarkably like the artist formerly known as Prince. I left the International Monetary Fund at the end of April this year and have taken on a number of smaller jobs, including the chair of the advisory board of the Oxford Centre for the Analysis of Resource-Rich Economies. I'm also on the advisory board of the NRGI and delighted to take this role today. We have a very distinguished panel of excellent contributors, which includes Carole Nakhle, well known to many people as first of all an expert on UK oil and gas taxation, and now much more broadly internationally, and has founded her own company now called Crystol Energy, which is an advisory work in this area. We have Salli, Swartz, who is a practicing lawyer with Artus Wise in Paris, and has long years of experience with contract work and contract negotiation. Then we have Satya Yudha, who is not only a member of the House of Representatives in Indonesia, but the vice chairman of one of its most important commissions, which covers energy and mineral resources. And finally, agreeing to serve us after we needed a little strengthening was Tony Paul, also on the advisory council of the NRGI, and known to many of you as an expert on oil and gas with long experience in Trinidad and elsewhere. So I'm delighted to welcome everybody. Thomas Lassau and David Manley have published and distributed on the web a rather nice background piece about the issue of fiscal terms with the fall in the oil prices. I was struck there by a remarkable coincidence, because some years ago, Carlos Queiroz, then with Revenue Watch, I think still, published a piece about renegotiation of contract terms in response to the rise in oil prices. And very surprisingly, I think the number of countries he sampled at that point was 38. And remarkably, the same number of countries appear in the piece by Thomas and David Manley as those who have moved or renegotiated the other way following the fall in prices. I don't think the sample is the same. I've put one or two questions to our colleagues here. First of all, they may wish to make observations on whether it makes a difference that the fiscal regime in a country is contractual rather than set out in general law. We tend to assume from a developing country background that the system will be contractual. It's not everywhere, and there is often a hot debate about the merits of whether a system should be contractual or in general law, as it is in most rich countries. The second question, of course, is the question of how costs respond to the change in prices. For our economists, what is the elasticity of the cost response with respect to a unit movement in price? Because, of course, that too is going to affect the taxable capacity. Next, it'd be interesting to know how taxes that contain, or not just taxes, but sharing devices that contain specific triggers that do things in certain circumstances, how those are behaving in the current circumstances. And lastly, what commitment technologies might there be, whether of a contractual nature or in fiscal design, that would make a difference to the stability arrangements through good times and bad. Now, our first three speakers will have something of a focus on particular context, but Carole is going to set the general context, and she has a maximum of 10 minutes. You're welcome.
Thank you very much, Philip. Good afternoon, everyone. Well, the oil price is definitely the most obvious trigger of changes in the relationship between host governments and investors. You know, those two players, they want to share the same pie, and tension definitely prevails between them. So we talk here about how the oil price is going to impact the bargaining power between those two players at the negotiating table. There was a very nice study published by the Chatham House that was the lead author, Professor Stevens, in 2013, showing a negative relationship between the oil price movement and the cases of international arbitration. So when the oil price is high, we can see the number of arbitration increasing, and the oil price drops, it decreases. So that's why I wanted to take two minutes to talk a little bit about the oil price and the new dynamic that we are seeing today. First of all, I'm really amazed, and I frowned a lot throughout the conference and when I read the media articles, when people talk about low oil price, crash in the oil price. But since when $60 a barrel was such a bad thing? I mean, just think about it. We had much lower levels during the 80s and the 1990s. And what we saw between 2011 and 2014, mid-2014, was actually not an unusual, not a usual situation, not a normal situation. It was just a question of time before we went back to normality. When you talk about the oil price, it's a global commodity, we have volatility. So that's the first observation on the oil price. Now, this brings me to the relevant point about our discussion. Are we going, as governments, for instance, are we going to chase movements in the oil price using the fiscal regime? Now, imagine how what that will result into, especially that our experience in forecasting the oil price has been rather very disappointing. So. This is an important aspect. I've seen, like Philip mentioned, my experience with the UK. That's where I did my PhD almost 11 years ago. And it drove me crazy when I was trying to trace the changes in the fiscal regimes on the North Sea that the UK government has introduced. And I've given up recently because it was too difficult to keep track of all the changes that were introduced. And what does that result into? It results in instability, which adds to the investment risk. It results in complexity of the regime. We may have here in Europe, for instance, or in the developed world, perhaps enough capacity, administrative capacity, to handle this complexity. But when you're talking about the developing world, such administrative capacity is rather limited. So by simply chasing the oil price and continuously tinkering the fiscal terms instead of allowing them to adjust automatically, you're going to end up with very complex system, very different terms between, you know, varying with years, with projects, with companies, you name it, that becomes very difficult to control, to manage, or to compare. I remember my previous life, one of the first projects I was doing for an oil company was before 2008, the rise in resource nationalism. Then 2008, in the summer, we had the crash in the oil price, and I had to move my paper, change the tone into the decline in resource nationalism. And I feel today the situation is more like a deja vu. So if I think of certain countries that have introduced some serious fiscal changes and changing their contractual framework, I have on my list, of course, Mexico, but I'm not going to indulge into that. Perhaps, you know, we have experts, they can comment on that. The UK, I just mentioned, we saw several changes recently. But think of Iraq with its massive oil reserves. Iraq had a very aggressive attitude towards investors. If you may recall, its first licensing rounds was the take it or leave it attitude in 2009, then the following years. Then recently, only a few months ago, the Iraqi government announced it was renegotiating those contracts to allow greater flexibility, to allow their system, which is called service agreement, but of a longer duration, to be closer to a production sharing. The same thing Iran. Iran announced last year that it was going to offer new fiscal terms, new contractual arrangements that will be, and I quote the minister, more competitive than what its neighbors are offering. Another country that comes to my mind, Egypt. You may have heard that recently the Egyptian government made history by signing a concessionary agreement with BP, which was resisted by the media and the public, and they called it like this is squandering the national wealth, wrongly in my view, because we cannot reach such conclusions without really studying the terms in detail. Algeria is another country that comes to my mind. They introduced legislative changes, they introduced new tax incentives to encourage difficult fields, smaller fields, and of course they have the unconventional share resources in mind. Now, just to go back to the topic of this, the question of our session, which is it going to be a race to the bottom? As I said earlier, is really $60 low that to call it bottom? And second, I find the decline in the oil price an opportunity. Yes, we have cost cutting. Yes, we have companies becoming more selective in terms of where they are spending, they're allocating their capital, their capex. But it's also good news. It's nice to be shaken from time to time, to become more efficient, to become more disciplined. So it has a positive aspect. However, the countries I listed, what we saw in reaction to the oil price, it was not just a reaction to the oil price. Those countries, the oil price has simply exacerbated an already difficult situation. Production and investment were declining in those countries. So the nice group of countries I listed has already a lot of problems before the decline in oil price. But when the oil price went down and the loss of revenues materialized significantly, we saw this race into changing the fiscal terms and, in some cases, legislation. Now, this brings me to my main message here, the fiscal regime. The fiscal regime plays a very important role because it is the main source of revenue for the government. It shapes the relationship between government and oil companies. And I am completely against this continuous tinkering for the reasons I mentioned in the morning. But this brings me to my main message here, that the issue is not about the total government take or one tax instrument or the royalty is too low or the royalty is too high. It's the design of the whole fiscal regime. So when we talk about the petroleum fiscal regime, we need to keep in mind a holistic understanding of how the regime works and, of course, understand the nitty-gritty details, because I always argue that when it comes to the fiscal regime, the devil is in the details. I come from Lebanon, and last year we had a big argument about the royalty rate, and a lot of articles were published. So the whole debate was narrowed into royalty, whether royalty was at a low level or at a high level. And the people were discussing that issue, including government officials, completely forgot the other aspects of the fiscal regime. And that really limits our understanding. When I talk about design, what I mean is that, we discuss later the issue of flexibility, but not by going and adjusting it manually. You can think of it as automatic adjustment to changes in conditions, to changes in opportunities. And then finally, just to conclude in line with the question raised in the outline for the session, that yes, there may be an opportunity for oil companies today because they can negotiate more attractive terms for governments, especially governments are under pressure to keep a certain level of spending in the developing world in particular. But I always warn of the dangers of negotiating very attractive fiscal terms from the company's perspective, because they are suddenly stable. So at some point, the pendulum is going to swing back and it's going to shift the bargaining power to the government, and we're going to see this instability. To address the question raised by our chairman on the contractual framework in the developing world, it's true, we tend to see, for example, production sharing, service agreements, but there are many countries also who have other arrangements, concessionary, I can think of Ghana, for instance. When I try to understand why these countries would go for contractual arrangements, originally, if you think of the history, it was mainly to allow governments a greater control over natural resource. In my view, as an economist, I don't think that the choice of the regime would determine how much power or control you have over your resources. Really, the whole institutional framework that would determine that. One reason can be the poor income tax legislation, for instance. And so there are so many risks, but the issue of the resource national ownership, is not one that is convincing enough for me. Then just to, because I know I have 1 minute left, I want to conclude on the cost issue. I don't have the figure on the elasticity, but we have this fact that costs usually follow prices with a time lag of 6 to 9 months. And you know, just changing our fiscal regime on the basis of prices is looking only at half of the equation, if not a quarter of it, and we should keep the other aspects in perspective.
Thank you very much, Carole, for keeping to time. I take two important messages from what you say. One is that in relation to costs, the oil price may not be as low as we think. I would gloss on that, but we've also seen some evidence that maybe the metallic commodities would have potential for recovery. And you also stressed the virtues of stability in fiscal regime over time. Those are important messages. Now I'd like to turn to our colleague from Indonesia, Satya Yudha, and offer you your platform.
Right, thank you very much, Philips. What just been mentioned by Carole is quite inspiring for Indonesia, to be honest, because of now we have to see how strong and how resilient Indonesia as a government, you know, toward the falling of oil price. None of the economists in the world, it's quite difficult to predict about the oil price. What happened in the US, they're improving their production capacity up to 2 million within 2 years. And, you know, OPEC still maintain the productions. And the China economy, you know, they're lowering the target of the economy growth. All those factors impact to the oil price. But it is as it is. We have to face it. So the Indonesian governments in the past, you know, it's not in the past, but at least in 2015, we set our budget with the assumption that crude oil price is $105 per barrel. Well, we're trying to revise, you know, based on what happened in the current oil price to $60. It impacts a lot of the government revenues. It's almost 60% of our government revenues drop, you know, counted that the about $10 billion that we drop from the revenue. But on the other hand, it's quite coincident that the Indonesian government has a policy to remove the subsidy. But that's not because of falling of oil price, but because of we are struggling for many years, you know, on the subsidy issue. So we are able to manage, coincidentally with the oil price drop. And the subsidy that we spend, the money that we spend for the subsidy is almost $23 billion back in 2015 before we removed the subsidy. And now we are maintaining to $5.16 billion, which is dropped 76%, quite significantly. So when I trying to see, you know, how resilient Indonesia facing with the oil price drop, it may impact to how we behave, how the Indonesian government behaves toward the private sector, toward the investor who invests in the oil and gas sectors. So Indonesia, if you look at from the budget as a macro pictures, so we have a current deficit account on January to May 2015 is around, you know, if we are using the British assumption with the oil price of $105 per barrel, it's about $5.5 billion. Well, now, because of the oil price, and we goes down to $1.9 billion, which is good and bad. You know, it's good in terms of the current deficit account, bad because of the other revenues also going down. So let me now go to the industry perspective, you know, on the oil and gas industry. There is at least one example here that I like to put into the table is Pertamina is their own enterprise. They commit to have a activities and exploration activities on the world on the work program budget around 118 well to be developed, and 2015 onward. But they revised it just only 26 development well, which is 77.96% drop because of the oil price circumstances. The book offers also the same thing. And if you look at from the low commitment of the explorers, we are struggling to maintain our reserve replacement ratio on oil because we are expecting to have a reserve replacement ratio on oil is more than 50% because of oil in Indonesia is quite declining from time to time. While on the gas sectors, we are quite happy to see the figure because of the reserve replacement ratio is more than 100%. So meaning that we have more gas there than oil. So how do we see with that strategy? We knew that our revenue is going down. We know that we have to anticipate what the contractors, as the PSC contractor to the government of Indonesia, doing. So we have to do something. Before I go to the detail, how do we treat our contract, our existing contract with the production sharing contractors? But there are several issues that it's really. Make it difficult for the investor to invest. You know, I can see the very compact bureaucratic and regulatory regimes. It does exist with or without the oil price falling down. But it is in our radar screen as a parliamentarian, so we have to give a feedback to the governments to do more simple and not too bureaucratic. The second issue that was raised by the Indonesian Petroleum Association is slow decision-making process on the expansion of the contract. As they consider that Indonesia, partly on the western part of Indonesia, is mature field, so many contracts have been expired and need to be extended. There is not such a firm regulation on that. So that is also one of the challenges for the contractors. And all those regulations sometimes create uncertainty. So this homework that need to be done. And the other important thing is the complexity of dealing with many levels of the government due to the regional autonomy. It's Indonesia entering the democracy era, and you know the autonomy to the local is quite significantly moved from the centralized governments to the more authority to the local. This also become a so many approval need to be obtained by the investors, you know, in dealing with that kind of thing. Particularly on the land acquisition issues, the overlapping issues, those kind of social issues that need to be resolved before the investor actually invest. So in Indonesia, even though you have a license to operate, it is not necessary that you can operate directly. You have to deal with so many bureaucratic issues and in this regard. So if you look at from the problem that the government have, so. Me as a parliamentarian, I'm also overseeing the energy sectors, trying to push the governments to revise the unnecessary regulations in order to simplify the bureaucracy, even though some of them have been done by the government as time to the government administration. They simplify the process from more than 100 permits, now just only simplify become less than 30 or 40 of a permit, so but yet to be proved in the future, and so what we do with the existing contracts? If you look at the PSC contract in Indonesia, it's quite rigid. You see, the contractor before they invest, they have to get approval on the plan of development. On the plan of development, there is a set of criteria what the oil price they are going to use as a reference, and also what's the economic. Liability that they have to obtain. So when there is any changes in the oil price, then there will be another renegotiation with the government. They have to sit down and ask for that approval in order to make the contract more economically viable. So that kind of type of contract is quite rigid at the moment. Just only few contracts, which is quite sensitive, is linked to the profitability. This is what happened in my district with ExxonMobil operation, where their contracts is based on the sensitivity to the oil price, using the sliding scale. So if the price goes down, so the profit split will be in favor of the contractors more. Yeah, the government probably just only get the 54%, while when the price goes up, and then the portion of the government is as a bidder. So there's just only one or two contracts in Indonesia that are sensitive to the oil price. The other contract is asked, you know, the contractor to sit down and to renegotiate. So what's the solution? The solution is either we promote type of contract with link to profitability, or the second one is using the contract with putting the hybrid negotiated stabilization clause. Just inserted that. So if there is a challenge for the ROR of the project, particular project, there is a space for the investor to come and to renegotiate the developments. So that's all about Indonesia at the moment, and I'd like to elaborate more if there is any questions. Thank you.
That's marvelous, Satya. Thank you very much. I think you've given us an important piece of macro background, and I noticed the very great importance of saying that how the government responds to this depends a little bit what other fiscal space the government is creating. And you've raised the important point about using the opportunity to reduce subsidies that you may have underway anyway, but would create fiscal room that that will assist in dealing with reduced revenues from oil. I also noted, and I think it was of great importance, that you're making the point that in order to maintain investment, it isn't just a matter of softening terms when one is pressed to do this. There are all sorts of steps that one needs anyway, which include streamlining the regulatory process, assisting with the complexities and levels of government and that sort of thing. I also noticed you came to the end on the question of flexibility of price, but I do have to come back to this question, and I've always thought there's an anomaly in gearing fiscal regimes to prices, because we know and everybody knows that costs follow prices. So if you simply gear the regime to price, you may have the paradox that in a period of high prices, you tax more on a squeezed profit margin, and in periods of low prices, you tax less on a higher profit margin if you purely gear the fiscal regime to price. And that seems to me to be slightly problematic, but good for discussion. Tony Paul, your 10 minutes, please.
I wanted to have a picture up here. This is to illustrate the context of Trinidad and Tobago. So for those of you who are not familiar, Trinidad and Tobago are two small islands in the Caribbean, next door to Venezuela. That's fortuitous because, as you know, eastern Venezuela is has the biggest oil reserves in the world, and we are part of that basin. Now, oil is so prolific, it's been coming up on the ground for centuries. And we actually started exploring oil in the 1850s and started commercial production in 1908. And our first refinery in 1912, our first natural gas to power in 1953, and natural gas to petrochemicals, ammonia and urea, and fertilizer in 1959. During the Second World War, Trinidad had the biggest refinery in the British Empire. If you look at the graphic, you see in green oil production and in red natural gas production. And you see peaks and troughs in oil production. And if you look really closely, you see that actually the peaks coincided with some of the major high oil price events in the entire world. So just during the Second World War, when I was already on the team of Ontario, the 1970s after the Aral oil embargo, and then natural gas prices took off rapidly in the late 90s, early 2000s. When our gas production grew tremendously. Now, what it says is that historically, Trinidad and Tobago has been through all kinds of peaks and troughs in reserves, in production, investment, climate, but also in prices. And since 1962, when we became independent, we were clear putting in good institutional frameworks, regulatory frameworks, including a Petroleum Act and Petroleum Taxes Act, and a ministry to regulate those. What we also did quite well at the time is to build strong capacity in the ministries of both finance and energy and petroleum. And what we were able to do is to track the industry and respond to changes quite flexibly. And what we did, and we did a whole series of things, and I won't go through all of them, but I'll categorize them and give some examples and some of the pros and cons of those examples. So we gradually implemented two mechanisms for responding to price changes. One was contractual, of course, and the other was fiscal, as everybody else does. Now, to complicate matters, we had two contract regimes. We had initially, on the 69-70 Act, tax, a concessionary system with tax and royalties. But we also did have a production sharing regime that really didn't kick in a big way until the 90s. We had some in the 70s. Now, so here's what happened. In the 70s, the production came from concessions, tax and royalty. Our prices went up, we got good returns on those. We were able, through the fiscal regime system, to change taxes and increase taxes as prices went up across the board. In the 80s, when oil prices dropped, it wasn't so easy to respond because taking taxes down meant some companies would benefit disproportionately to others, and we didn't want that. So we introduced more production sharing contracts where companies could be rewarded based on the amount they produced and, of course, on the value of what they produced. Initially, we did not have cost recovery in those contracts. And when prices went down and costs were proportionately higher, it wasn't attractive to the government, but we wouldn't get any taxes. So we introduced ceilings, caps on cost recovery. As time went on and things were changing, when higher prices came, we found we weren't benefiting from the higher prices in production sharing contracts in the way we could in concessions. In concessions, we can change taxes. In production sharing contracts, we couldn't. In the late 1990s, when we were going to deep water exploration for the very first time, we were told unequivocally that deep water exploration in Trinidad and Tobago could not work under the current fiscal regime. So we had to amend it. And we said, fine, we agree, but we don't know what is the right number. So here's what we did. We said, let the market tell us what the right regime is. So we created a production sharing contract with a sharing matrix that had on one axis levels of production, another axis bands of price, one for oil and one for gas. And we asked companies, please bid on this so we know what they're willing to pay. Now, what I did in addition is gave us some flexibility in getting higher tax rates at higher prices. So we knew that companies would bid high at high prices, and lower on realistic prices, but that didn't matter. So what we did to evaluate that is create our own expected earnings, expected value matrices, and come up with an analysis mechanism for those contracts. As it turns out, we had Exxon, Shell, Arco, Amoco, Petrobras, Mobil bidding on these blocks. And every single bid, bar none, gave the government a rate of return take higher than the existing tax regime, which we were told prior to auction was not at all feasible. So we ended up getting higher taxes because we bid the tax rate, essentially. Now, this is back in the 90s. Our highest band was set at $75 and above. And people said, you guys are crazy. You never get $75. Why put that? But guess what? As we all know, when oil reached $100, people said, you guys were crazy. Why did you stop at $75? So having learned from that, what we've done actually in the new contract is put a sliding scale at the highest end. So we've captured that. So we've done that in the production sharing contracts. In the concession system, we were doing it through the fiscal regime. What we also have in the fiscal regime is a supplemental petroleum tax, or windfall profit tax regime, which initially was set quite high because it came in when oil prices were high. Over time, we've had to adjust that and make it more realistic. As time evolved, what we also did is to make it more targeted. So for instance, if you wanted to incentivize or not penalize heavy oil, mature fields, deep water, we have different bands of SPT, petroleum tax, windfall profits tax, for those special circumstances. So what the fiscal regime did, it allows us to be more targeted in addressing specific concerns at different times. So at the moment, for instance, we want to go after smaller gas fields. All those gas fields you see developed to produce develop those plants, those fields, or those plants, are for massive fields. We have dozens of smaller fields, which may not work in the current fiscal regime. So we change the tax regime to address those smaller fields. So that sets up two things. One, it creates some responsiveness to the special circumstances, but it also creates a responsibility for a competent and responsible regulator.
Now, when we started life in the 60s, we did build a very strong regulator, and we maintained that for a very long time. A lot of our systems depended on a strong regulator. At times, the regulator wasn't so strong. Not that the people weren't good, but that there was sometimes outside influence. So when I look at the mechanisms we designed, one set was automatic. It was systemic. It happened when it kicked in when oil prices changed or gas prices changed. Another system was administrative. It gave some discretion and some cause for influence. So one of the biggest failures in that would be to the left side, my left, your right, where the gas prices, the gas production took off. Now those black markers on those red bars indicate new gas plants that were built to consume gas. Each and every one of those plants were sanctioned with gas at $2 an MMCF. Right after they were built, of course, in the early 2000s, gas went through the roof. What it meant is that there was a windfall profit. But guess what? We had no windfall profit tax for oil, for gas, sorry. The SPT only addressed oil. So the push was, let's put in place a windfall profit tax on natural gas. Why? Because the one company with the most production of natural gas also wasn't paying any royalties for natural gas, because the contracts were older and didn't contemplate value from natural gas. As it turns out, as we know, discretion enables influence. And the outcome is a measure of the power balance. Late in the game, we were told as the population that the contract was renegotiated and we will get an increase in royalty to 12.5%. What we weren't told until years later is that that won't kick in until 2017. So we didn't introduce an SPT or royalty, and all that excess profit wasn't captured in the way the oil profits were. Mm-hmm. Bottom line is this, we had two systems, one that gave a lot of room for discretion, one that didn't. What we found is that the way discretion was used works really well when you have a strong regulator with good competence. It doesn't work really well when you haven't got that. So what we've merged to is a combination, a congruence of a regulatory system that is responsive. So now our laws have an SPT that has bands, that has a matrix of its own. So the windfall profit taxes in law has production levels and price levels. And it has a third dimension which targets different kinds of operations. So deep water, heavy oil, shallow water, deep drilling. Yeah? So again, to conclude, the systems were dynamic, they responded to changing circumstances, they evolved with experiences, we made some very good decisions, we made some mistakes, we tried to learn from them, and I think those learnings have helped us get into a better place. We're not quite there yet, but it's always a work in progress. Thank you.
Tony, thank you very, very much. I'm struck by a couple of things there. First is your remark about when you introduced the PSA with the matrix system, that you got bids that you perceived as higher than under the special petroleum tax system. That is a phenomenon I've observed elsewhere, and it seems to me counterintuitive, and I'm not entirely sure why companies do it, and I'd be very interested to hear the response. Particularly from companies who otherwise tend to say they would prefer not to have production sharing systems. Second is that you rightly drawn attention to an appropriate understanding of the potential for gas. The possibility of excess revenues there seems often, and not only in Trinidad, to have been driven down by the idea that this is an industrial commodity with domestic use. Whereas if you're a small country like Trinidad with a large quantity, you're going to export a lot and you want to capture the rent, as indeed is an issue for Indonesia. And the third lesson I think we would get from what you say is, however difficult it is, the importance at a fairly early stage of trying to introduce a flexible and responsive mechanism that will avoid the need for too much renegotiation. But it's a very interesting history. One thing you did not say, and which Trinidad shares, I think, in common with a number of others, is that you have actually built credibility of dealing with this over a rather long period of time. And that counts for rather a lot, I think, in fiscal take. If I may, I turn to Salli.
Thank you, Philip. Well, before I get started, I wanted to make a few disclosures here. I think I'm probably the only non-economist in the room, so I hope you will excuse me if my little interlude here is based on legal contract negotiations and discussions with governments over their legislative frameworks. I'm not very good at numbers, and I always work with economists. What I'm good at is looking over the last 30 years that I've been doing this on where parties break down and when they have to come back to the table. By way of reference, I co-authored an article that is on the Columbia Center on Sustainable Investment site on renegotiating, reviewing periodic reviews of long-term extractive industry contracts, much of which I'm about to say is actually part of this article, so it's not all that original, but the article isn't that old either. It's only about a year old, so bear with me. Now, I'd like to address one of Philip's first questions, which is, are we better off with the legislative framework, or are we better off with the contractual framework? I actually think, based on my very few years of experience, that it probably doesn't matter, all right? Because the countries that want to have a strong legislative framework and then go ahead and legislate a mining code or a petroleum code tend to change it every election cycle. So in a sense, and actually I've been told that the UK keeps revising its code, so that isn't just a question of where the country lies in terms of the North-South divide. So my experience has been, it's nice to have a legislative framework because that does, in some sense, reduce the possibility for corruption. Because if you know that your legislative code only allows a 4% rent or royalty, well, then paying somebody to get it more won't do much of a job. In contract negotiations, it's true that they are more risky in the sense that you're going into an open field. And as you said, Tony, a lot of the countries that are bidding will overbid because they really want that field or that permit, or there may be other reasons as well. But my experience has been that no matter what regime you walk into, whether it's legislative or a somewhat legislative, meaning there's a broad legislative regime but which has some flexibility that is supplemented by contracts, you're still going to have a situation over 20, 30 years where one of the parties is going to be unhappy. And it's going to be unhappy because things change, and lots of things change. Right now we're talking about low prices. In 10 years we might be talking about high prices, as we were, as Carole mentioned. We might be talking about operating costs that have gone off the board because the local communities have not been properly consulted, and they have blocked a site for 2 years before a good mediator came in. I mean, there was all sorts of things that happened in the field that can change parties' financial objectives. What I would like to bring to the table today, and I've been told it's a good idea by some, and I've been told by others it's a really stupid idea, you know, I kind of like the way I feel about the whoever gave the right to the French to go on strike. So I will let the economists here decide whether or not it's feasible. My idea, which has been written on, is in any given contract, and I'm talking about extractive industries because that's what we're here for today, but it could apply and has applied in PPIs and PPPs and infrastructure contracts. The parties have financial objectives. They do financial simulations. They know what they're looking for in a rate of return. They pretty much know, or should know, and generally do know, despite what I've been told sometimes to the contrary, what their CapEx may be, because we put caps on the deductibility of CapEx when we have a profit tax. They probably were not quite sure what their OPEX is, but you know, every company investor has an idea of what that investor hopes to have on its return. And the government needs to know what it expects. Otherwise, I don't know how it can define a fiscal regime, be it legislatively or be it by contract. Now, you're the people out there that know how to do that. I don't, okay? But things change, right? So what do you do at that point? Well, if you've got a legislative regime, that's fairly robust, most companies will ask for stabilization clauses.
Correct.
Talked a bit about that. Now, there are all kinds of stabilization clauses, and I'm not here today to go over them, but there are basically stabilization clauses that say, me company, you government, you don't change anything ever going forward from what it is today when I sign this contract, because I'm not going to get, I did all my financial simulations, and if you change it, I'm going to lose money. That's what I would call the most rigid form of a stabilization clause. There are other types that say, if you change your fiscal regime, then we have to sit down and talk about it, because it might have an effect on us, company. And then there's a third type, and there are hybrids between the three, of course, but and then there's a third kind that says, you change your fiscal regime, you pay me for my losses. And that's when you get all the economists in that do scenarios on how much profit they've actually potentially lost by a change in a fiscal regime. So those are what happens when you have a quote-unquote, and I don't mean this in a pejorative manner, a fairly clear, rigid fiscal regime that is set out in some written text and then is provided for in negotiations by way of stabilizations. My personal and professional experience is I don't like stabilization clauses. I think they do everybody no good, to use horrible English. I think that the prediction and the financial simulations that occur at the time consortiums and governments enter into contracts are just that. Their expectations, their simulations, and so many things can change that what ends up happening is the governments have an incentive to change their fiscal codes in order to avoid windfall tax profit. Mm-hmm. So we end up chasing the tail of it. Mm. What I would like to suggest is that when a company, a consortium, an investor sits down, having obtained the right to explore, and therefore having made the go, no-go decision, because until then, we don't really have a lot to talk about, that each of the party to the contract do its financial and economic homework and simulations. If they can share them, subject to a very strict confidentiality agreement and an escrow agreement, that would be wonderful. But, you know, we're probably in la-la land there. If they can't share them, it would be good if they shared the result of the calculation by putting it into a mathematical formula, and here's my challenge to you, which is made up of objective criteria that can be verified, such as oil or gas or gold prices, you know, if we're talking about mining, that has a number of variables in it that can be plugged in at each given defined periods during the life of a contract. Now, we all know there are phases of contracts. At the beginning, the company invests very heavily, and then the company hopes to get a return, and then the government comes in and starts taxing that return, et cetera, et cetera. And then you have the wind down stage way there in the future. The idea is to share a sufficient amount of knowledge so that the disproportion in knowledge base is evened out to some extent, to talk about expectations, financial returns, and then to write into whatever contractual arrangements there are. It may be, what, overtime?
No, you're getting there.
Write it into whatever contractual arrangements there are, because even when there is a very, very detailed legislative framework, there are always additional contracts that are signed. To write it in so that the parties know that if any given time they feel that they are disadvantaged by situations, objective situations, or objective triggers, that they can plug it back into this formula. If you've decided to have a delta variation on the formula, that's fine too. And then to sit down and say, me company, I was expecting a 20% ROI in the seventh year or the eighth year, right? And what I'm actually getting is 3%. Have it sufficiently detailed so that there's not a credibility gap, and we hope that there wouldn't be, by means that are sufficiently protected. And the government might say, yes, and I had a royalty rate of you know, 7%, and you haven't been paying it, or that's probably not bringing me in what I thought it was going to bring in, or I've got a corporate rate tax on profit, but you know what? You've been declaring zero profit, okay? So that's not helping me. Okay. So there's the idea.
Good.
I will throw it back to the chairman of this panel and my panelists. But it speaks to your issue on hybrid matrix systems, which I really do believe can be written into a structure that could be legislative or could be contractual, so that there is a reason and an obligation to sit down and fix it before there's expropriation and before there's arbitration.
Thank you, Salli. I think there's a great deal of material there. We just recall that you have said that you don't see a lot of difference, a lot of concern as between legislative and contractual systems. Both can be made to work. You are not an enthusiast for stabilization clauses, something about which I have myself written, and have some sympathy with what you say. And last of all, you've come out with your idea, which I have seen in some form in some contracts, some pieces of work.
I never said it was all that.
No, never mind. I'm sure not, but it's sufficiently important to float with objective criteria. Now, do we have our microphone wielders? That is wonderful. I'd like to take perhaps about three interventions first, so we can take the temper of the room and the topics that are of most interest, and then we'll move from there. Lee Bailey is the boss of the Twitter feed, and after we have the first three questions, I'd not perhaps like him to read out Twitter feed, but if he can give me two sentences on what's coming through, that would be brilliant. So may we look for number one there, is the first eye I catch, in the Kitenge shirt. And there, and there.
Hi, the question is kind of posed first to Salli.
But could you say who you are, please?
I'm Mark Beer. I'm from Oxford Policy Management. I thought your inputs were great. I've been involved in Tanzania recently, where the whole issue of contracts has become, depending on your perspective, and raising its ugly head or something to look forward to. Two things. One thing, and perhaps comment on that, is firstly, throughout your explanation, I never heard the word transparency once. And I'm raising it because I think that in the context of where we're sitting today in this conference, transparency is a critical issue. And there are a number of contracts out there where the biggest challenge has been precisely the fact that they're as complex and as hybrid and as whatever you want them, but because they haven't been transparent, that's been the problem. And exactly as happened in Tanzania when the Statoil contract was exposed publicly and it turns out that they got a better deal than anybody else, et cetera, et cetera. But it then leads to the second point, which I'd like you to comment on, and that's this issue of the host government agreements. That a lot of countries, where they're in a position where they do not have an established regulatory framework, there is enormous pressure from the investors to then sign these host government agreements. But when you look at the terms of them, they're actually preemptive regulatory frameworks. So you end up, as a country, selling your sovereignty into an agreement that's made with one project with a consortium of private investors that effectively defines the rules of the game for the next 20 to 30 years, including whether it's stabilization clauses or whatever else it might be. And the problem with these is that then if there's any default on these contracts, very often BITs are then thrown in the face of the country, of the host government. And then we have the absurd situation, for example, where I think it's JP Morris is suing the Australian government at the moment via a BIT with, I think, Hong Kong, over its attempt to introduce the writing on cigarette packs to stop smoking because they believe that it's impacting negatively on the decisions they made as investments. Okay,
thanks very much. I'll invite our second over here, and could we try to focus a little bit on the issue of the issue of the price changes and the commodity cycle? Yes, please.
Yeah, I'm Carlos Bellerin. I work for IHS, but this comment is entirely personal. Salli, you're not the only lawyer in this room.
Okay.
There is another one.
And,
another thing, there is a fourth type of rebalancing clause now introduced by Mexico, in which you can rebalance and recover any economic, if the economic balance of the contract is affected, you can recover it through cost recovery. That's a new one. And very clever. That's what happened when you put an economist and a lawyer in a room for 2 days without food or water. another thing, for the gentleman over there, about the BITs and companies using BITs arbitrations. If you see Venezuela, which is the second country with more arbitration against the ICSIC, you will see, if you see the numbers, you will see that Venezuela has done very well in defending through BIT. So it's not what we read in the press, it's what actually is happening.
Okay, thank you very much. Albert.
Yes, I'm Albert Zufak from the World Bank. One quick question to Tony. I was on auctions. I would probably want you to elaborate a little bit more as to what made it happen in Trinidad. And Philip earlier asked you, why do you think companies do this? Why did they do this? My question is rather on the other side of the coin, which is, you know, why governments, you advise, why don't they do that more often? And from your experience, especially advising African countries, what is preventing them from doing exactly what you just described?
Okay, thank you very much. Anyone urgent at this point who'd like to add, or we can go back to the panel? One thing I haven't heard mentioned very much so far is the question of the effect of the composition of the fiscal regime. Clearly, if you have profit and cash flow-based taxes, they are to some extent self-adjusting to the situation and prices. There's perfectly good reason why you would have flat rate levies and royalties, but clearly they are a lot less flexible in responding to price changes, which we need to recall. Carole, would you like to comment on, I saw the question of transparency coming in, the comprehensiveness of agreements that were referred to as host government agreements, the new style in Mexico, the ability of Venezuela to resist investment treaties, and how to get more people to do what Trinidad has managed to do.
Let me start with the issue of transparency. I mean, of course, it's an important aspect, and we come across many situations where we cannot access signed contracts because of the confidentiality agreement. Now, okay, I appreciate there are some confidentiality agreements, but the fiscal terms, I think to keep them confidential causes many problems. How am I going to know whether the government has signed the right deal or not if I cannot model those terms, I just use assumptions. So this takes me to perhaps a point I should have emphasized earlier, you know, the legislating the fiscal terms that apply to oil and gas sector, keep it transparent so we know what is being applied, and avoid negotiating case by case in terms of fiscal terms. What you tend to negotiate sometimes is that, for example, if you have some variable parameters like signature bonus, which is a biddable parameter, but the main instruments that can generate revenues for the government, I don't think they should be negotiated on a contract-by-contract basis. Now, I'm not saying that everything should be... I'm not saying, for example, if we're talking about auctioning, I'll comment on this aspect in a minute, that you cannot go into direct negotiations, for example, with companies, but you can make even that process transparent by publishing the negotiation outcome. So transparency is very important, and it starts, I think, in my opinion, other people have divergent opinion, is to put the fiscal terms quite clear in the law or make them transparent rather than negotiating them on a case-by-case basis. Now, in terms of for stabilization, a colleague of mine and I are currently writing a paper on the evolution of the stabilization provision over the last 15, 20 years to see whether any lessons have been learned today, especially in today's environment that people are calling for more transparency in the contracts. And you know, we reached the conclusion after we studied more than 20 countries, we also did a survey of opinion among industry, lawyers, NGOs, that no lessons have been learned. So really that is the conclusion, that despite 15, 20 years of argument about transparency, we still find, you know, companies calling for stabilization of the terms in the contract and divergence. But at the end, you know, Governments are at the end the sovereign owners of the resource, and they can do whatever they want. So this raises the question of the effectiveness of stabilization provisions. I'm not a lawyer, but companies recognize that, but they still go for such mechanism for main reason, maybe to keep the government, the host government, behaving, and, you know, thinking twice before changing the terms. So of course there are long-term impacts, and we saw the case of Venezuela speaks for itself. The issue of auctions, I'm a big fan of auctions, competitive bidding. It builds on the competitive instinct of the oil companies, and we saw how Iraq managed to get very, very lucrative deals from the government perspective because of the competition was very strong. But this does not necessarily mean that every single auction is going to be successful. You need to show respect to transparency. You need to have well-defined parameters. You need to follow the whole process. We cannot say, I have auctions, therefore I have a transparent and well-functioning system. There are prerequisites. And of course, one requirement for auctions is to have tough competition. Angola, I always like to use Angola with their signature bonus that made history, $1.1 or $1.2 billion signature bonus in 2006 because competition was very strong. Now, yes, competition or auctioning should have the priority, but also the choice of the biddable parameters are equally important. So I'm not a fan of offering the fiscal terms as apart from signature bonus, which is as a biddable parameter. I would go for the work program, for instance, and keep them limited. I mean, in the US, the law, I think, does not allow the use more than one biddable parameter. So there are all sorts of aspects that can determine whether auctioning is going to succeed or not.
Okay, let me turn to Tony, because I think the issue of the bidding on the a scheme in Trinidad is important, and I think it does raise the transparency issue. On one occasion some years ago, when I looked at the Trinidad production sharing contract, there were 61 biddable variables. Now that seems to me like rather a lot, and I wonder how transparency meshes with having that number of biddable variables. Tony.
I suspect 61 is a slight exaggeration. But Trinidad is something of an anomaly. We've had many experiences, but they're not very well documented. Trinidad scores very high on the revenue governance index, but it's not very transparent in terms of contracts. So we haven't got good transparency on E&P licenses or production sharing contracts. So they're accessible in some ways, but not easy, and we don't document well. So to your point, Albert, we recognize that there were competing demands for the same acreage. And I can give examples, and I gave one recently where a prime minister was asked to take to the cabinet a request for a license over a block in exchange for what we call a seismic option. In other words, the company would just shoot some seismic, and based on that promise, they will have the license. If they made something interesting, then they would drill, right? We'd had previous requests from different companies who had committed to drill, yeah? So the minister came to me as director of geology and geophysics and said, what should we do? And I said, in spite of your request from the prime minister, I suggest we go back to the cabinet with a request for a bid round. Why? Because there's competition making. We did that and had a very good competitive bid round. Now, to get a good bid round requires you to have a good understanding of several things. One, the resource you have on offer. Two, the market for that resource. Not only the demand, but who are the 8 players that you will invite and how you attract them. And it requires you understanding their strategies. Are they interested in your part of the world? Your type of geology, for instance. It takes some knowing. And the better you are at that, the better you are at getting good bids. So having a bid in itself is not a panacea for good exploration. In fact, very often, from time to time, and quite often sometimes, while I'm an advocate for auctions, there are times when it's better not to have an auction. Why would I say that? We don't find oil and gas because we have a license. We find oil and gas because we have an understanding of the geology that may be unique based on our experiences. And sometimes companies come to governments and say, this is my understanding of your geology. This is how I would explore for it. This is what I expect to find. And this may be unique from that person's perspective. And the government may say, I want to try that. I haven't had other options. This one I like. Do you bid an idea? Or do you go to tender? Then how do you evaluate? So To Philip's point, you do have different evaluation criteria depending on what you're trying to achieve and what is available. So we did have times have criteria based on analysis. But the second question is, why aren't other people doing it? People are getting a lot of advice and support on policies and legislation, but implementing bid rounds is not straightforward. Implementing anything requires specific capabilities. I described very simply for you what it took to do that bid round, understanding and getting it right. Governments haven't got the capacity yet to analyze it. Now, you can say, fine, let the market tell you, and we can do that. It's happening. In Ghana, in the new ENP bill, there's provision for auctions as the standard approach. Yeah? But there are outside forces that influence government decision that don't want, necessarily want, license auctions.
I think that's very important, Tony, and I think one of the economic issues that's raised for Sally's proposal is the issue of how you would treat auctions and bidding within a context like that. Because for take an extreme example, say you pay at the beginning a very high bonus as a result of a bid, and you have criteria for reinvestigating the contract in it, can you expect to be compensated because things don't turn out well and you made a bid that happened to be too high? It's not obvious to me that that is a way one would go with bidding. And it seems to me that the scheme that Sally has in mind is much more suited to the idea of bilateral monopoly in negotiations when there isn't a competition and when the government and the company are essentially monopolists on both sides and are bargaining things out. Just before we go to others, are there any other audience things? Quite a few. Let us take right over there in the corner. Was that the lady below David? Yes. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Nina Bernarding. I'm working for a peace-building NGO called Constellation Resources, and my question goes into a bit different direction. I was wondering if you have come across the correlation between low or high oil prices and human rights standards in contracts. Or environmental standards also.
Okay, that's up. That's an interesting new angle. Let us take, which was the second? Charles, I think I saw you, and then the lady here.
All right, Charles McPherson, independent consultant, is also associated with the University of Dundee. But Philip's point, I think, was very good about the contribution that automatic adjustment in fiscal terms can make to stabilization. And I think that the panelists also were interested in that. But I think what's very important is how that automatic adjustment works, whether it's based on expectations of what's going to happen, which seem to be reflected in both, Sally, your expectations based on the forecasts that were made at the time of the deal, or in your case, Tony, expectations based on a matrix you assembled of what you thought profitability would be. But the other alternative is to actually tie it directly to profitability, which I think you were referring to. Mm-hmm. Did either of the two of you consider that, the rate of return-based system or the R-factor system? Mm-hmm. Rather than, it would be a great deal simpler, for example, than a matrix, but it seems to me.
One more here in the front, second row, before we can just come back to Sally and Satya.
Hi, first of all, thank you very much for your remarks today. I think that this panel has...
Could you say your...
Sorry, yes, thank you. My name is Chantal Jordison, and I work with the School of Public Policy at the University of Calgary through the Extractive Resource Governance Program we have there. So my question is about any regional trends that maybe you see emerging in terms of the race to the bottom. And if it's too early to say in result of these kind of the price changes, to say if there's any regional trends, are there any worrisome trends that are emerging around certain resources? So whether that's deep offshore or if it's certain minerals that, you know, are kind of showing a bit of worrisome trends.
Thank you very much. Satya, I'll let you come in at this point, and then Sally, if we may, before taking another round.
Correct. It is a case-by-case basis, is my understanding, to respond to your question, you know, because of different country, different characteristic of the basins. And in Indonesia, for instance, if there is a contract for the deep water, so now it depends on the negotiation between the government and the PSC contractors, because they have to provide with bunch of reasons, you know, saying that apply the advanced technology, for instance, and also providing that good human resources in order to apply that kind of technology. And also they probably can propose with certain number of rate of returns. So the government's quite open in Indonesia because of the way we do auctions based on setting of the criteria. So profit split is one of them. You know, raising this technology is also one option. So now it depends on how the company who part of the auctions give a sweeteners, you know, looking at the frontier area, for instance, because of, you know, level of difficulties of that area is quite high, and then you know, the negotiation based on more on the technologies that they are offering. So that's.
Thank you very much, Salli. You've had a number of responses to thoughts of yours, so you might wish to come back.
Right. I'd like to come back on the transparency issue. I'm not sure what aspect of transparency disclosure you're talking about, but just for the record, I am highly in favor of all contracts and all fiscal regimes being published. I'm also in favor of them being approved by the legislature, however hopefully it exists, right? What I was particularly referring to is the communication of what may be considered proprietary information by an investor with regard to financial simulations on rate of returns. I can understand why certain data may need to be or remain confidential, but I join my colleague Carole here in saying that the result of whatever is decided must be transparent, must be public, and it must be approved by a democratic process, if I can use that term. So I apologize if that wasn't clear when I gave my presentation. I took that as a given, actually. Maybe I shouldn't have. With regard to auctions, and your comment, Philip, I join Tony's comment. Auctions are not always appropriate. It really depends on what resources there, what you're needing from the investor, what kind of mineral, or is it offshore or onshore? You know, all of those, I think, make great sense. If we're doing an auction, however, I disagree with you, Philip, when you say that the idea of writing into a long-term relationship cannot be part of an auction process. I disagree, because when you write up your technical specs and your public disclosure and your geological information and the feasibility, the requirement for the feasibility study and the plan, the work program, all of that, you can also write in the matrix or the elements by which that contract or that relationship will be renegotiable depending upon certain aspects. So I don't agree that it's bilateral, necessarily a bilateral or a trilateral, because we haven't really talked about funders, but some of these projects need to be bankable, and therefore the financial institutions are either parties to it or need to approve it. So those would be trilateral, I would say. I guess my last point, on bits. Bits are a problem. I mean, they've always been a problem in terms of local content, which are illegal under certain bits, and then you have barter arrangements and local community development that has given rise to an entire specialty on arbitration. Luckily, I started practice before anyone ever signed a bilateral investment treaty, so I never got into that field. But my last thing is on human rights, and I'd like to quote Peter Rundle, if I may, because in a prior panel, he said something which I thought was quite clever, and it applies to my response. He said, quote, "What do smoking, corruption, and contracts all have in common?" I won't ask you the question because we're running out of time, but I'll give you the answer. It's price inflexibility. That's what he said, okay? I take no ownership of that, but I think it's quite a good phrase. In my mind, price up, price down has no effect on business and human rights, okay? Why? Because you're either going to do it right or you're not. And the portion of companies' balance sheets, if they were to set it forth and separate it, isolate it, that they spend on the investment in human rights in any given project, you have nobody has any idea how much they're investing. So it's not clear to me that that's part of the bottom line. And until someone shows me the numbers to the contrary, I don't think it varies at all. So that's my response.
That's great. Thank you very much for that. I hear from the discussion that we are repeatedly being driven back to the view that although there are changes in fiscal regimes going on, and although there are contract negotiations, the core principles of how we should design these fiscal regimes, and whether, for example, we should be defending human rights and activities, those things do not change. And we are very much in the same area. Mm-hmm. Could I ask if there
Can
are...
Can I comment just on the regional
please?
Trends?
Yes. Take hands in the same, at the same time.
Yeah. Usually, I mean, typically what you find is that government, certain countries always look at their neighbors, what they are doing. You know, there's a sense of competition for resources and what my neighbor is doing, I can do similar, I can do better because I want to attract investment. That said, you also have diverging behavior. Like look here at the UK and Norway, they share the same sea, and yet we have one country which is famous for its unstable fiscal regime, and the other one is famous for having one of the most stable regimes in the world. So it's difficult to generalize, but the trend I notice in the developing world in particular, they always like to compare with what their neighbors are doing. It's not always a fair comparison because the geological potential can be very different. The domestic needs or the local conditions, the economy, all these are very different. That's why I personally like when you compare with other countries, but I am against just parachuting or copying a system and then implement it in your country. All needs need to be tailored. But one area which I'm finding is capturing increasing the attention is unconventional, whether heavy oil or shale gas or shale oil. So that would be a new area where we're seeing governments expressing greater interest into.
Thank you, that's very good. Yes, Keith, I see your hand.
Talking about fiscal, but the title's about contractual terms too, and thinking about relinquishments and license relinquishment provisions within contracts, the timing, the sort of control that government has over timing and approvals. Those things give government a huge amount of leverage, and I just interested in the panel's thoughts, because that's a key element in terms of committing to fiscal terms at the expiration stage for assets. You don't know how big they're going to be, how good they're going to be. You must get your relinquishment provisions in very tightly defined so that you don't end up having very generous fiscal terms applied to all the fields that get discovered.
Very, 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 very good point. And I think it emphasizes the point that we can't consider, for example, having a separate channel of discussion about stability assurances is not a good idea, because it has to be seen in context of everything else. I'm going to ask our panel for some last remarks. We have 4 minutes, so they have a minute each. And Tony, I think I saw your head in first.
No, just Charles and Keith, he's the only other geologist in the room besides myself. Charles and Keith make a similar point. It's about how do we get that kind of economic stabilization without calling it that. And Keith, to your point, in Trinidad, what we've done recently is adding contract reopener clauses. That may work, but to me, I think there's a case to be made to let us have a discussion after the exploration phase on what the fiscal regime is for production, which is like in mining.
Exactly.
Yeah? But what we also have to remember is that many of these licenses in existence are old and are generally written at a time when the country was in a weak position. This creates a great opportunity for countries now, because as companies come to say, let's look at the fiscal terms, governments must realize that the door is open for everything in that contract. Everything. Because once you want something from me, I have power over you.
Okay.
Yeah? Governments have to be prepared with what they want and to negotiate to get something better than they did 15 years ago.
Very good. Satya.
Yeah. In the case of Indonesia, sovereignty is an issue. It's sometimes it's quite difficult to entertain both sides. You know, one side is suffering the issue, and the other side is how do we cope with the international, multinational corporation needs, you know, in order to be to compete as a country, to compete with the other country. So the way we manage, you know, and oil is quite clear, like I mentioned earlier, that we have a thoughts about, you know, whether we put the hybrid negotiated stabilization clause or we put the link to the profitability sliding scale based on the sensitivity to the oil price. But on the gas issue, this is quite different. Gas issue primarily dominated by the local, for local buyers, which is heavily regulated. So quite difficult to put into contract. So the thing that more important on the gas contract is basically there is a room for the investor to renegotiate based on buyers. Because one buyer to another buyer, even one reservoir, one reserve, there will be a different price because of different buyers in domestic market. So now how do we combine, you know, between the oil and also the gas with the sovereignty, with how do we be more flexible? So, and the other thing that I like to raise here is basically we knew that sometimes we have to give an incentive on the tax. But Indonesia as a whole, we are aiming to have a more revenue from the taxes. So that's kind of thing probably need to be provided by room to negotiate between the government and the contractors.
Okay, thank you, Salli. Your last intervention.
Yes, thank you, Philip. I think the only thing I would add to this very interesting discussion is that in response to the last common question, it's a basket of variables, not only fiscal, but development, but revenue, but there's lots of things that go into that basket, including time for approvals and fairness in treating applications and, you know, relinquished times and all of that. So I guess my message is that it is tax revenue or fiscal revenue is extremely important, but as you said, it's not alone out there. You're right. I need to know how fast I'm going to get my permit, how fast I have to do a go, and are you going to respect those administrative constraints? Because otherwise, my investors, my shareholders, my funders are going to come back and say, this is not a serious investment. So I think that when we're looking at codifying whatever it is that we want to codify, including administrative procedures for the granting, relinquishing, and the like of permits, concessions, and whatever, we being either the investor or the government, we've mm-hmm. got to be there understanding each other's position. And I think that has been lacking in these old contracts because there was a huge difference in the negotiating capacities and the knowledge base of the parties who are negotiating. That's my final word.
Very good. Carole, you have answered.
Yes, I'm going to add one dimension, which we've been talking about government versus oil companies. But actually, there is one important aspect when designing a properly functioning regime, fiscal, institutional, you name it, for oil and gas, which is a coordination between ministries. I've been to countries where the Ministry of Finance does not know at all what the Ministry of Energy or Petroleum is doing. So there is not just transparency with the public, there is the issue of transparency and coordination between various ministries, and I think that is that we should not forget. I mean, that's a very important aspect.
Thank you, Carole. That's essential. The negotiating team has to talk to each other.
Yeah.
Well, I think that is great. And I thank you all very, very much. I do take this important lesson that even if there are responses to the price changes, there are a lot of issues and principles that continue through the cycle. I'd just like to end recalling what Carole said earlier with an observation made to me some years ago by a senior tax manager of a major oil company who I think is retired these days. But his company had operated on both sides of the divide in the North Sea. On the Norwegian side and the British side. And with reference to issues of stability, he said, well, you know, we've operated in the Norwegian sector of the North Sea, and we have benefited from long years of stability in the fiscal regime, and we have paid heavily for it. And we have worked on the UK side of the North Sea, and we have suffered grave instability in the fiscal regime, but we have benefited enormously from it. So with that, please join me, thank our panel.